Hello, everybody. Welcome to Wednesday Night Poetry. I am your host, Kai Coggin. And thank you so much for everybody that's joining us tonight. It's going to be a really big and beautiful night, a special night, because today is actually the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. Earth Day. So what I did was I made a special wish about a week ago that one of our Poetry Earth Mothers would come to Wednesday Night Poetry virtually and share a poem with us. And I wished really, really hard. And I wished for Naomi Shihab-Nye. And I wished for Jane Hirshfield. And I wished for our United States Poet Laureate, Joy Harjo. And I wished, and the universe answered. And tonight we have not one, not two, but three of our Poetry Earth Mothers with us tonight. All three of them, three stars in a line, three Poetry Earth Mothers in a beautiful constellation of hope and beauty and honesty and light. Gosh, if you think that, you know, prayers don't get answered or wishes don't manifest or goodness doesn't just bloom when we all need it, this should be proof that it does. So tonight, yes, we have the United States Poet Laureate, Joy Harjo. We have the Young People's Poet Laureate, Naomi Shihab-Nye. And we have the radiant and impeccable Jane Hirshfield joining us for the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. So before they get started, I just want to tell you a little bit about Wednesday Night Poetry. So I am Kai Coggin, I am your host. It started February 1st, 1989 by a man named Bud Kenny. And whenever there was a special occasion, Bud would wear a top hat. And so tonight is a pretty special occasion, so I am definitely donning my top hat for him and for this evening, for you all, and for our Earth Mothers of Poetry that are joining us. It started in February 1st, 1989, like I said, and we have actually never missed a single week of poetry in 1,630 weeks in a row. That's right, through ice storms and floods and tornadoes and blackouts, and even this pandemic that's affecting all of us all over the world, there has still been Wednesday Night Poetry. So thank you so much for being a part of our streak, a part of our legacy. Sounds like the frogs are gonna join us too. So it's Earth Day. I told them they could come to the party. Hope that's cool with you guys. So I am coming to you guys from Hot Springs National Park, Arkansas, my home in Hot Springs National Park, Arkansas. We usually have Wednesday Night Poetry at a place called Collective Coffee and Tea, and it is a coffee shop in downtown Hot Springs. Tonight, Naomi and Jane Hirshfield both wanted to give their $100 honorariums to members of Collective Coffee and Tea. So Olivia and Brett, you both have $100 coming to you from these two Poetry Earth Mothers. They gave their donations to you. So that's awesome. Thank you for your generosity. Let's see. So yeah, we're the longest running poetry series in the country. I opened it up virtually 6 weeks ago today. This is a volume 6 of Wednesday Night Poetry. I just said, we can't let our streak die, so we're going to keep it going. And that's what we've done. And it's kind of grown exponentially because poets need community. We thrive on community. We thrive on sharing and writing, especially during a time like this. And so that's where we are. We're at volume 6. Just to say where we actually are, today is April 22nd, 2020. The coronavirus has claimed over 40,000 of our countrymen. This is my 38th day in quarantine. I know many of you guys are struggling out there, and what I have done at the beginning of every Wednesday Night Poetry virtual open mic is this. I've reached out my hand because there are so many of you out there that are going through this alone. So I want you to go ahead, touch my hand, put your hand up to the screen. And I'm sending you so much love, and I'm sending you community, and I'm letting you know that you are not alone. I feel you. I want you to take care of yourself and be gentle with your... Don't let go. Be gentle with yourself. Stay in your jammies all day if you want to. It's okay. We're gonna make it through this. I know it's hard, but you are not alone. You ready? All right, let's get to some poetry. So I'm gonna start tonight off with a poem that I wrote about the love of my life. And speaking of Earth Mothers, this one, whew, she's a master naturalist, and she's the one that actually got this city girl to love nature, to live in this beautiful space. And she was just featured on her magazine right here in Hot Springs for her love of nature and her just vibrant, beautiful spirit. So I'm going to read a poem that I wrote about her. I probably should have bookmarked it. Okay, I found it. So this poem is from my third collection, Incandescent, which was put out in 2019 by Sibling Rivalry Press right here in Arkansas. And Joanne actually did the paintings for this and my other two books. She's an amazing artist as well as a naturalist. So this poem is called She Made Our Home a Wildlife Sanctuary. And this is from my favorite Earth Mother, my love, Joanne. I notice I never mix up fresh batches of sugar water for the hummingbirds. I never toss more bird seed into the numerous feeders. I never plant and water green things to root and burrow into bloom. It is her toil to be in the soil like that, for her hands to sprinkle sunflower and stir sweet nectar, a different stage in life, a different scope on creation. Her labor is for all the wild things, all the growing. Last week, our house became a certified registered wildlife habitat. She even sent in approval applications to the National Wildlife Federation to name our home a safe haven, a safe space for hooves and wings. We had to have food, a water source, trees for cover, places to raise young, and other requirements that I do not even know, because she applied and I didn't, to make our house a sanctuary for the untamed, a forest refuge for the feral, and her labor is for the unprotected, for the innocent. The fleeing deer drink from our lake here. They eat the soft grasses from our fields. Fawn peek through morning mist. White tails flicker between skinny pines. Purple spray paint on our property border trees say that these acres are safe from hunters. Every migrating species of bird passes through the Grand Central Station of her love here, knowing she has the black oil sunflower, Niger, thistle, bright oranges, and care. The chipmunks have tunneled elaborate underground cities in our orchard of fruit trees. The raccoons and squirrels scurry in the oaks, shaking branches that wave with gratitude. The singing red fox hurls his love songs and croons from a boulder here that faces the moon. The 10,000 frog chorus harmonizes with the whippoorwill. Fireflies blink in updrafts, and the night is always a symphony. The government even sent her a metal sign that she nailed gently to the front of our house, a black bear in a ranger hat, and the words, Certified Wildlife Habitat. This property is recognized for its commitment to sustainably provide the essential elements for wildlife. See, all the wild, wild things have made this home, have settled into the space our love leaves between leaves, have claimed the paths that our feet carve from forest. We share the air and music and movement of this land, but I must admit, it is all by the labor of her loving hands, this constant gardener, bird feeder, dream builder, queen. My wild, wild heart, life, soul, found refuge and safety in her. Thank you. Little gnats are buzzing around. It's almost summer. So Earth Mothers, they're everywhere. You probably know one yourself. I do. I know one. I love one. But let's get to our poetry, Earth Mothers. Before we do that, Joy Harjo is going to be first, but I want to recognize a couple of people. First, I want to recognize the climate activist, the young person whose voice sparked such global change and brought this conversation to the forefront of our consciousness. I want to recognize Greta Thunberg. Greta Thunberg. If you don't know who she is, learn. Greta Thunberg, 16-year-old girl from Sweden. The next person I want to recognize is Rainey Ortiz. She is Joy Harjo's daughter, and she is an amazing native bead worker artist. She made this necklace for me. I don't know if she's taking special orders right now, but her name is Rainey Ortiz, and she does beautiful, beautiful, intricate work. Support artists right now. Support musicians and poets and songwriters. Support us here at Wednesday Night Poetry, and you are just by being here. So let's get to our poets, our Earth Mothers. Please comment and share on the poems that you like. Poets don't like to speak out into the void. We need feedback. We need love. So leave comments for these poets, not just our Earth Mothers, but all the poets that are after that. They've worked hard to share their voices with you tonight. Again, I'm Kai Coggin. I'm really, really honored to welcome our United States Poet Laureate, Joy Harjo.
I'm Joy Harjo, and I'm here in Tulsa, Oklahoma, which is also the Muscogee Creek Nation. And I'm here with a poem or a series, a little small series to honor the earth called My House is the Red Earth. My house is the red earth. It could be the center of the world. I've heard New York, Paris, Tokyo called the center of the world, but I say it's magnificently humble. You could drive by and miss it. Radio waves can obscure it. Words cannot construct it, for there are some sounds left to sacred, wordless form. For instance, that fool crow picking through trash near the corral understands the center of the world is greasy scraps of fat. Just ask him. He doesn't have to say that the earth has turned scarlet to fierce belief after centuries of heartbreak and laughter. He perches on the blue bowl of the sky and laughs. If you look with the mind of the swirling earth near Shiprock, you become the land beautiful and understand how three crows at the edge of the world laughing become three crows at the edge of the highway laughing. Don't bother the earth spirit who lives here. She is working on a story, and it's the oldest story in the world, and it is delicate, changing. If she sees you watching, she'll invite you in for coffee, and you will be obligated to stay and listen, but this is no ordinary story. You will have to endure earthquakes, lightning, the deaths of all those you love, the most blinding beauty. It's a story so compelling, you may never want to leave. This is how she traps you. See that stone finger over there? That is the only one who ever escaped. And I'm going to read Sunrise. It's a poem for these times about finding ourselves here in this place on Earth, with Earth, as Earth. Sunrise. Sunrise, as you enter the houses of everyone here, find us. We've been crashing for days, or has it been years? Find us beneath the shadow of this yearning mountain crying here. We have been sick with sour longing and the jangling of fears. Our spirits rise up in the dark because we hear doves in cottonwoods calling forth the sun. We struggled with a monster and lost. Our bodies were tossed in the pile of kill. We rotted there. We were ashamed, and we told ourselves for 1,000 years we didn't deserve anything but this. And one day, in relentless eternity, our spirits discern movement of prayers carried toward the sun. And this morning, we are able to stand with all the rest and welcome you here. We move with the lightness of being, and we will go where there's a place for us.
It's a great honor to be joining Wednesday Night Poetry on this 50th anniversary of Earth Day, to be joining all of you who care about the world through the ways of poetry's caring, distillation, music, concentration, feeling and thought joined towards the magnification and clarification of our lives, our public lives and those decisions that affect everyone, our lives in the community of all beings, and our lives of the interior and the private. Because it is Earth Day, I thought I would read you this poem from the new book Ledger, which covers a lot of ground. It talks about evolution, it talks about land formation, it talks about terrorism, it talks about the crisis of the refugees in the Mediterranean, and it talks about our compact with one another, and that it is a changeable compact. Day beginning with seeing the International Space Station and a full moon over the Gulf of Mexico and all its invisible fishes. None of this had to happen. Not Florida, not the ibis's beak, not water, not the horseshoe crab's empty body, and not the living starfish. Evolution might have turned left at the corner and gone down another street entirely. The asteroid might have missed. The seams of limestone need not have been susceptible to sand and mangroves. The radio might have found a different music. The hips of one man and the hips of another might have stood beside each other on a bus in Aleppo and recognized themselves as long-lost brothers. The key could have broken off in the lock, and the nail can refused its lid. I might have been the fish the brown pelican swallowed. You might have been the way the moon kept not setting, long after we thought it would, long after the sun was catching inside the low wave curls coming in at a certain angle. The light might not have been eaten again by its moving. If the unbearable were not weightless, we might yet buckle under the grief of what hasn't changed yet. Across the world, a man pulls a woman from the water, from which the leapt-from overfilled boat has entirely vanished. From the water pulls one child, another. Both are living, and both will continue to live. This did not have to happen. No part of this had to happen.
Next up, the Young People's Poet Laureate, Naomi Shihab-Nye.
Hello, friends of poetry, friends of Kai. Thank you for inviting me to be part of your reading. I have two poems from the last few weeks that I'll share. Many of us have been thinking about a lot of people in our solitude, people we don't get to see or people we can't see with our presences anymore in the world, but so many visitations we can have even by ourselves, and poetry helps with that. But I found myself thinking deeply of a relative for the first time in many years. So this is for her. It's called Making Birds Happy. I'm reminded again of my odd great aunt, Hilda, of Southside Chicago, how she stayed in her upstairs room voluntarily for 16 years, reading and writing, feeding birds from her windowsill. No medical reason anyone knew about, an eccentricity nobody asked about. And what was wrong with us that we didn't ask more questions then? Luckily, her housemate dashed up and down the steep wooden stairs 50 times a day to bring her food and mail and 20 loaves of bread delivered straight from a bakery. They weren't even dressed in wrappers yet. They came on a tray. She wore her pajamas for 16 years, alternating pink to apricot. I remember her tearing the bread into skinny strips, telling me I should travel to England, try to meet Prince Charles. He would be a great catch for a husband, as if I might qualify. I was 10, nodding respectfully, kicking my legs from the edge of her very high mattress. Visiting Hilda felt like visiting a museum or a shrine. Once she'd been married, given singing lessons at the grand piano in her living room, written poems, and published them in ladies' magazines, wreathed in floral fantasy. I suppose I should have questioned my leaning toward poetry at that point, but something in her steady presence at the windowsill, her scrawly blue pages arriving in the mail every week, heartened me. I think of her now, during quarantine, how expert she would be at this style of isolation. And this morning, 4 weeks in, grieving so many unknown friends, missing grandson and mingling and poetry in big rooms and everything we used to know, even our own crazy neighbors hanging out in our living rooms, hours on end, drinking tea, doing as little as we do now, but still feeling exhausted, dutifully feeding birds 1,000 miles south of Chicago, I definitely bow down. In the other poem, thinking about words, I'll put on the other video. This is called Poem Menu. Dear Chula, remember how discussing simple phrases gave the greatest pleasure to be out of sorts or beside oneself, for example, because when did people ever feel in sorts or inside oneself or mention when they did? Somehow our echoes, floating conversations from college days, are helping me hold the quarantine more kindly. We're all okay, but just this moment, how many gasp and die? Who could not feel out of one's mind? While we putter around our cozy homes, staying safe and sane as all the letters finish now, the count ticks up. Feeling beside myself at every minute for you and you. Here's my hope. Those surviving will get a menu, a set of memories still to think about, an unfinished song, new plans, a group of phrases folded on a beautiful card like the poem menus on hospital trays in Ireland, the poems for patients. I was asked to pick 1 year, all 22 of them, from writers big and small, voices one might wish to meet, beside the pudding or jello. It was the best job I ever had. While recovering from surgery or sickness, a patient would find a surprise toast to back to life, slow time, succulent words nicely arranged, and maybe feel their own groggy heads echoing response. Oh, that reminds me of, then something more to think about. How millions are wishing you all longer lives, ourselves as well. But where is hither and yon, for example? Do they have the virus there?
I still can't believe we just had these three Earth Mothers read for us right here at Wednesday Night Poetry. Thank you so much, Joy Harjo. Thank you so much, Naomi Shihab-Nye. Thank you so much, Jane Hirshfield. You make us strive to be more tender, to be more honest, to be more real in our poems. Thank you for being such guiding stars to us all.
There's a poem in this place.
In the footfalls, in the halls.
In the quiet beat of the seats.
It is here at the curtain of day
that America writes a lyric
you must whisper to say.
There's a poem in Boston's Copley Square.
Where protest chants tear through the air like sheets of rain.
Where love of the many swallows hatred of the few.
There's a poem in Charlottesville.
Where men so white, they gleam blue. Seem like statues.
Where men heap that long wax burning ever higher.
Where heather higher blooms forever in the meadow of resistance.
Hay un poema en Puerto Rico.
And in East Texas.
Where streets swell into a nexus of rivers.
There's a lyric in California where thousands of students march for blocks.
Undocumented and unafraid.
Where my friend finds the power to blossom in deadlock.
Her spirit, the bedrock of her community.
She knows hope is like a stubborn ship gripping a dock.
A truth that you can't stop a dreamer or knock down a dream.
How could this not be her city, su nación?
Our country.
Nuestra América.
Our American lyric to write.
A poem. By the people.
The poor, the Protestant,
the Muslim, the Jew,
the native, the immigrant,
the black, the brown,
the blind, the brave,
the undocumented and undeterred,
the woman, the man, the non-binary,
the white, the trans,
the ally to all of the above and more.
Tyrants fear the poet.
Now that we know it, we can't blow it.
We owe it to show it,
not slow it.
Although it hurts to sow it.
When the world skirts below it.
Hope, we must bestow it.
Like a wick in the poet so it can grow lit.
Bringing with it stories to rewrite.
The story of an American city depleted but not defeated.
A history written that need not be repeated.
A nation composed but not yet completed.
There's a poem in this place.
A poem in America.
A poet in every American. Who rewrites this nation.
Who tells a story worthy of being told on this minnow of an earth.
To breathe hope into a palimpsest of time.
A poet in every American.
Who sees that a poem penned
doesn't mean our poems end.
There's a place where this poem dwells.
It is here, it is now.
In the yellow song of dawn's bell.
Where we write an American lyric.
We are just beginning to tell.
Hi, my name is Molly Bessrechter. I'm the director of Open Mouth Reading Series in Fayetteville. Really excited to be able to virtually participate in Wednesday Night Poetry. I'm going to read a cento that I made, and a cento is a poem composed entirely of lines by other people. So it's called Why Survive? Why survive? To see if it was true, to see what comes next, to give the body a chance, to be, but you are also in air and sand and earth, to go on a run somewhere with lindens, to match the zigzag of the clear sky's lightning, its alien script across the sky, to host the latter-day bee who is a midwife by virtue, to marvel at time, at the long reach of life's bottomless watering, to drink in the afternoon and to celebrate the anniversary of a lakeside bar, to feel possessed of a soul that's better schooled under a dome of choral sound, to be both music and comfort, to mark arrangements of blue, to be drenched and dried in the sun's bright voltage, to see her stumbling out on the other shore, sending up a riot of yellow flowers, to see her knees, oh God, the thin tendons, to leave behind belonging for moving, to try to explain where you are, the jumbled, sun-bleached universe, hold on, to say wisdom will come, to mean no harm, or to not, especially just now, be looking for it, to stand on desert dirt, wishing stars would fall. Another bright reminder, belief is not a requirement to go on living. Nevertheless, live.
For Liz, on the day that walking on the beach is forbidden. A beach is an occasion, a skin scalded by sun, a bird-speckled distance, the ghost of oceans, a stone beaten, a cold star fallen. The beach is an open aperture, a mirror silvered, its future is glass. The beach is a passage, a kelpie fastness in bronze and brass, a twisted strand of blonde netted in hexagons, a shield and a scimitar, a stony-hearted invader. The beach escapes every definition, a landscape that shifts and sings, a happening between earth and sea, a constant inconstancy.
Hello, Wednesday Night Poetry. This is Team Ozel Brazil, and it's wonderful to be back with you again. I participated in your open mic a couple of years ago when my husband and I were serving as artists in residence at Hot Springs National Park. Totally fell in love with your community there. And it was also while I was there that I found out I won the Philip Levine Prize for Poetry for this book, Known by Salt, which is now out with Anhinga Press. And today I just wanted to read a very brand new poem, which is pretty rare for me. I'm usually a little nervous about sharing things that haven't been very well vetted by my readers. And this poem is called In Place. Wild irises can't flare fast enough. Now that our trips are kept to the woods. We pass dogwoods, opening their white crosses, and through the grasp and cling of briars, to the American chestnuts we planted, hoping to bring them back from blight. I find myself peering into each hole, wondering who lives there, wondering whose neck bends, legs curl, taking rest in a womb of soil, wanting them for neighbors. Am I somebody who this failed tree's roots yawn wide for? Who am I to take shelter in this place? Thank you again. It's a real honor to be with you.
Hi. I am Ren Gudino. I live in North Little Rock, Arkansas. I'm going to be singing a song called Weary Soldier. And thank you, Kai, for letting me be a part of Wednesday Night Poetry. I'm really excited. Press your head.
Happy 50th anniversary of Earth Day. My love and thanks to fellow sister Kai Coggin and to the Earth Mothers of Poetry that are reading today. I'm going to share a poem from Slide to Unlock. My name is Julie E. Blomicki, and I'm reading from Atlanta, Georgia. The title comes from James Dickey. It's all real within the dream. This is not monumental. We are sitting next to each other on the couch. Through the window, there is a sun. I am looking at your faded knee, denim fibers worn to fine over your most bendable places. We are holding hands. Everywhere, somewhere, people are holding hands. Even now in the poem, even as you read this, even when you find these forgotten words a lifetime later, we are holding hands. This is not remarkable. Forget that you live on one side of the world and I the other. Forget that it has been 17 years since I have seen you. This is ordinary, your hand in mine, me feeling a small pulse from your wrist. We are sitting on a couch, together. There is the sun. This is not extraordinary. We are looking to each other. I don't have to find you across wires, photos, pixelated text. There is the air of you. There is the air of me. There is our air together. We breathe. You, tangible in my senses. Me, tangible in yours. This is just a Tuesday. This is not remarkable. You say, when I look back over my life, I will count this as one of my happiest moments. Everywhere, people are holding hands. Everywhere, there is a sun, even when we turn from it. See, we are still holding hands. You have said those words to me. Still, we are sitting on the couch. You are wearing jeans. There is us. There were 17 years. We feel our hands together. We cannot stop looking. Everything is unremarkable. Somewhere, everyone is holding hands. The sun wants to slip to remind us. At last, we can touch each other. Don't wake me if it isn't true.
Power to the peaceful, Crystal C. Mercer here, and happy Earth Day! So wonderful to share this virtual space with you during Wednesday Night Poetry. All praises to the Queen Mother of the Warrior Tribe, Kai Coggin, for curating and keeping us together through poetry during the pandemic. I want to share a piece with you that came out as a freestyle, and I ended up transcribing it as I was on the phone with my best friend from college, Christian Harold Davis. He asked a question, and I said, yo, that's a poem. I need to record this. I'm feeling something. And so I want to pass that on to you and share with you what came out of our conversation as we're trying to hold each other up during this pandemic. Is anyone writing songs about this? While we drink our daily wine and take our daily piss? Is anyone capturing the lyrics and melody and timbre of what reverberates through our souls and our flesh and our weak and our dying? Where are our songs? Is anybody singing from their throat during this? While COVID runs rampant in our schools and our halls and our home, is anybody singing, humming, moaning, groaning? Where are the notes for our tragedy, our pain? Is anybody bringing bravado to our dead, to our weeping, to the new people that are born, that will die? Is anybody writing songs to this? Do they speak of the man that comes and goes, takes money from his shoebox fund? Do they speak of the mother breastfeeding in her dark apartment because her bills are still due? They were here, now they're gone, like those who died, and I wonder who, what, where, when, why, how, anybody, write a song for this. Thank you so much. Y'all keep each other close, and I'll see you next Wednesday. Peace.
Hi, good evening. I'm Cynthia Atkins. I'm so proud to be reading tonight for WNP Virtual Poem Open Mic, Poetry Through the Pandemic. This is Kai Coggin's baby that she's been curating so beautifully to help us poets through the pandemic, poets that need a venue with new people with new books like me that had the rug pulled out. So I really appreciate the space, the virtual time, the love, and the community. I'm going to be reading Proba Vita. In Latin, it means the cycles and seasons of life. It was named by my son, Eli. And this is called Proba Vita. Because it's a snapshot of spring, a bitter plum is open on a table like a ripe mouth, next to a girl reading a book from the library stamped return. Call off the spine sniffing dogs of dust, because fingers browse the card catalog of words, resisting arrest or rhyme. Because my house is empty as a theater after everyone goes home. Lights dim on the dusty long tongue of the interior aisle. Because the river is silent and wise as those prophets who drank whiskey by the railroad track. Because my womb is lined in taffeta, torn dress from a prom night where I'm still looking for a line from a song. Left it in a shoe in the closet where I hid from my sister holding a cap gun. My cheek brushing sleeve cuffs and the essence of my parents. Because my son's girlfriend is reading this poem, the universe shifts to the other foot. Because the river keeps moving and holds so many door keys, shoes, tin cans, gills of fish. We're kept out as if God or whoever is teaching us about boundaries. No matter what, doors compel us to knock. Skirts hold hems and pockets. Even the goalpost finds a shadow and stays just a hair over the line from the home team. Because flowers will be of no use here to serve up the hard facts. Petals are only for show or blush. Because the girl with long hair is reading a book beyond the grassy margins. A boy is sailing a paper airplane into the vast stratosphere of science and love. Thank you. Thank you, Kai. Reading for WNP Virtual Open Mic. poetry through the pandemic. Lovely, lovely to be here. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nebula in the Velvet Queen. I'm a poet and a jazz musician here in Brooklyn, in New York. I want to say a big thank you to Kai for organizing this open mic poetry night. I think that poetry is going to save the world, and especially in times like this. So thank you, Kai, for organizing this, and a big shout out to the other poets. I think you're all amazing, and I'm wishing you all peace and love and health in this time. I'm going to read a poem that I've written, among the many, many sad things about this pandemic is the increase in domestic violence that's happening all around the world, really. When people get put in small, tight places and everybody's stressed, people become violent. And so this is a poem about that. And it's called Wild Things Run Fast. The devil sits cross-legged before an angel under the chestnut tree by the wishing well, looking at the moon, but seeing the fool in it all. You want to be alpha. You don't want to be beta out there. It's a shark tank out there. It's a shark tank out there. The angel is silent for a moment. Then she says, people, they are capable of kindness, but sharks, they are not. The devil don't much like being walked on, but the angel says, the water washes off my back. She tells him the story of a king who gave his last cent to the poor. The devil ain't exactly in the good graces of his God. He who lets so many people suffer. But the angel says, those who are suffering are already with the angels. As if that is that. This incites the devil to a rage. He hates it when angels talk in riddles. But the angel whispers, someone has to lay down their weapon first. But the devil, he was born in the city. He paid for the stripes on his back with pieces of flesh. You don't know what it's like out there. You don't know. It's war. It's war. The angel takes pity on the devil. They kiss and caress. The angel knows one day the devil will have to choose between violence and love. But for now, she's content
to walk beside him. After all, she's part devil, too.
Hi, my name's Alina Stefanescu, and I'm going to do a little night reading. Night is another part that is beautiful about the earth, and there is a meteor shower happening tonight, and there are cars from the city of Birmingham behind me. And the poem that I'm going to read is from Stories to Read Aloud to Your Fetus. It's called, I Don't Think We Should Use Words Like Meadow Anymore. There is a meadow across from the subdivision, which does not belong to anyone. There are no lawnmowers on this meadow where a coterie of crows conduct their general assembly each morning. There is a four-way stop sign, but the stop looks ashamed, and some say there is a ghost that haunts the meadow, and what the stop sign feels is kin to dread. There is a crow whom the other crows caw around, and he is likely the lead crow, likely his name is Frank. There are parents who will not let their children play in the meadow because it is full of weeds and buttercups and fire ant mounds. The parents want someone to own the meadow and develop it. There are many ways to say develop without meaning to, but there are no ways to say development that do not involve the destruction of something else. There is a child developing their interpersonal skills, which means she learns to stop imagining the crows conversing in the meadow. The child will develop beyond freeze tag, and when she has developed appropriately, this child part will be dead. There is a distinct tinge of ache she will feel when passing the meadow, but the pain will be located in a phantom limb. There is no way to discuss the pain we feel in parts of us that don't exist anymore. There is a meadow and crows and fire ants. There is a place waiting to die. There will be cupcakes and ribbon-cutting ceremonies. There are people who will call the cupcakes an improvement. Thank you so much.
You don't know what it's like to be a haiku poet sheltering in place in North Little Rock, Arkansas. Let me show you. Sheltering in place. Nowhere is everywhere. Closed store window. Nude mannequin wears a mask. Coronavirus mask. Clouds cover the pink supermoon. Masked for pandemic. Can't see through the fog that comes from me. Restaurant closure. The ribs of the homeless dog. Small stimulus check. I break in half my dog's treat. Blues artist gone. How long since I've heard a whippoorwill. Zoom meeting. Leaning into the static of her smile. Neighborhood walk. During the shutdown, the sound of bird wings. Sheltering in place, everywhere is nowhere.
Hello, everybody. It's great to be back with you at Wednesday Night Poetry. Thank you, Kai, for keeping this great tradition alive. My name is Ken Haida, and tonight I want to read a poem from my collection, Not Quite Pilgrims, 2019 collection. The title of the poem is Something Resembling Beauty. I saw an artificial hill in Connecticut, tall and green, tall enough that I would have tired climbing its summit. Garbage lies beneath the green surface, years of garbage from thousands of citizens piled, packed, and piled higher and higher, reclaiming green space along a tree-lined parkway. I wonder how they knew when to stop piling. Who decided how much garbage was enough to make a hill, and just how tall a man-made hill should be? I'm a bit mixed. I like the idea of not leaving trash to its own decomposition. I'm sure we need to manage our waste. I kind of admire the attempt to make life, or at least the appearance of life, redemption, as it were, like poof, a mountain is made, sort of godlike, creating ex pergamentum. I don't know what cattle or cottontails might think were they to graze this grassy knoll, but I imagine children could make believe it's natural. So I'm kind of proud to be human, to belong to a species clever enough to reconstruct its refuse into something resembling beauty. However, I can't help but notice ventilation pipes protruding from the mound, breaking the surface, the underside, the hidden putrefaction, as always, is never really gone. And it's closer to the surface than we might wish to remember.
Hi, my name is Pam Yushuk, and I'm reading today from Tucson, Arizona. Thank you, Kai, for inviting us to read again today. Your series is terrific with its diverse voices. We're celebrating the 50th anniversary of Earth Day, which is a really important celebration this year. We've all noticed, I think, the lack of air pollution since the coronavirus. And personally, I love to go out at night and see the stars that are so clear now. Thank you, Mother Earth, for allowing us to live here. My poem is Counting Humpback Whales Off Cape Cod. Flippered sister, you shush to the surface, break iced water with your dense spine. From spent air, you sigh a fountain that shatters sky into rainbows. I've looked for you everywhere, the Pacific, Caribbean, Mediterranean, Aegean, Ionic, the warm sea of Cortez. And now you and your sisters gather like a tribe of tourists to watch this research vessel toss on the North Atlantic's frigid black back. My earliest memories are of being a panther lying in the wide eye of sun, juniper scenting my tongue, the thick pulse of milk in my breasts, the tug of my heart blood at the step of a doe rattling leaves, or of being a wolf howling at the haunches of my childhood through blue drifts of midnight tundra, snow cracking the leather moons of my paws. Still in my dreams, lizards and rabbits, coyotes and eagles talk to me. But you, humpback queen of dark water, you sing through unquenchable emptiness that never stops hoping for love. For love, you echo my heart, my blood, so that I can barely stand to watch you breach. Like an elegant tongue, 100 yards and millennium away. I have all I can do not to leap after you, to lay along the mammalian caress of your side, taking me totally into this world. Thank you.
Hello. I want to thank Kai for inviting us to read again, and all of us to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. I'm going to read a poem with two parts of earth, water, and stone. The poem is called Ways Water Has, and my name is William Pitt Root. It always moves and pleases me, these ways the ocean has with walls of adamant, urgent and lavish, restless as the moon, persistent as darkness. Even the lesser wave, as it meets stone, breaks into brilliance and that fluent whisper riotous in the graceful rush of foam. And look, see how these reefs admit and shed what washes over them, resisting and absorbing in a single stance the myriad approaches of the sea, and how carelessly the simple water fondles, shocks and undermines the fundamental granite. touch by touch. That innocent reduction of the upright cliff to puffs and swirls of dust, the wing beat of the least seabird can scatter. May I know a woman who has known the sea.
Hi, Wednesday Night Poetry viewers. My name is Gustavo Hernandez. I am a poet from Southern California. I am going to be sharing with you a poem entitled 2 Years that I recorded earlier today. I want to also take this opportunity to thank Kai for putting this wonderful virtual poetry reading together every week. I can imagine it is a lot of hard work, and I am very, very thankful. Thank you. 2 years, and the house is again a bouquet of June bugs and cement split nectarines. My mother is telling me a story about her father's family who hid their silver coins in pillowcases and under old fleece blankets. In it, she is still curious and a child. The neighbors are coming home from work, parking their utility vans, loosely coordinating food runs when my father finds his way into the story. He is heading east to purchase grain from that same family in the town of Jesus Maria. My mother now married, her body a strong sunset mesquite and wildflower field. Across the street, an unusually dense and active screen of sparrows splits and forms again. But to truly give you the time that has passed and to place you here today, it isn't enough to tell you that my father is gone, that I am not young. So I will say that I think myself smart enough to see and remember that no road behind us or in front of us is arbitrary or aimless. As a set of eyes, I recognize the sky and time and everything. That I've stopped trying to help her mourn him, unable to find even a proper translation for the act of grieving. That I know now my mother is not just my companion in watching these worlds shift and disappear. As she's weaving in the brown fluttering of the frenzied sparrows and the overflowing mouth of summer, I understand she is my guide.
Hey, I'm Stacey McAdee. I'm going to read an older piece entitled Sun Salutation. I'm not easily impressed by poems that are full of anger or ones that speak in synchronized sounds of standard slam tones. And if I see one more poet with an egotistical stance yelling stereotypical cliches, I just might throw up in my mouth. Obviously, I'm in a different place, a different space, but that doesn't mean that I don't understand hard times, grief, or oppression. And maybe, just maybe, because with the aforementioned, I've had intimate relations, I have little tolerance for BS. I want to hear and feel something more. Something beautiful, something hopeful, something real. The other day, my daughter gave me 2 of the best compliments that I've ever received. First, she said that I look like I found myself, although I must admit that I never knew I looked as though I were lost. And then she said that my hair reminds her of the sun, which I think is pretty cool since light and heat and vitality and healing and happiness are all linked to it. And since the sun is the source of energy and all life, I cannot think of anything or anyone else I'd like to resemble. The homemade slip and slide, front yard, water hose, water park, strawberry snow cones, kickball, bike rides, and neighborhood walks, booty shorts and barbecues, and in later years, beaches and books. Most of my fondest memories involve the sun. And my lowest points have always been in his absence. It's rained at the funeral of almost everyone I've loved and lost, so much so that until recently, I thought that was the norm and had convinced myself that that was God showing me how she and the angels mourned. And it was comforting for years until I went to one where the sun was shining and I was reminded of what his love feels like. I want to be like the sun. Radiant and multi-layered, where the light within me oozes outward and touches all those in my path so that they too can be clothed in the grace that has always been wrapped around me, that filled every void that prevented me from knowing that I was poor and ignorant. I want the core of my essence to be life-sustaining, felt, even when it's not seen, and a constant reminder that even in the midst of darkness, I will never fail to rise. Thank you.
Brick by brick, who laid the first brick? Stone by stone, tearing down homes. Brick by brick, who laid that first brick?
My name's Sky. This is a poem I actually just wrote yesterday, and it's called Night. It's the kind of dark that swallows headlights, and I can't seem to swallow this lump in my throat. I wish the darkness wouldn't spit me back out beneath the streetlights, grind me between stars and swallow me into the night, snuff me out like a cigarette too short to relight, useless to the user, just thankful to no longer be lit. Surely I've burned long enough. Surely night knows. We don't talk like we used to, but every moment spent devoid of light is a reminder of her presence and her promise to come back for me. Hope everyone's staying safe and staying home, and thank you to everyone that's still an essential employee right now.
I'm Susanna Case, and this is a poem inspired by a trip to India many years ago called Traveling Light. The Portuguese churches are full of doves that sound like the ghosts of crying babies sacrificed to a colony slavery, plantations on the shores of the Arabian Sea. But this evening, the sea is friendly, and it seems safe enough to sleep on the beach. Under a full moon, skeletal dogs keep guard, settle down near my feet until sunrise when they greet the fishing boats back today with kingfish and shark. On the main road where I go for sweet tea, Westerners in Indian dress, sari, dhoti, line up to score hash from locals in colorful polyester shirts. Gregory Peck drives by in a blue Mercedes in waves. Goa is like a movie set. In daylight, the ghosts are quiet. I play only a small role here. I wave back. Thank you.
Hi. This poem was actually a runner-up to be in the Texas Observer, chosen by Naomi Shihab-Nye. She actually picked a different poem than this one of mine to publish, but this was the second one that she praised, and I really love it. It's for my daughter. It's called For Frances When She Needs It, and I wrote it after a tumultuous divorce from her father. For Frances When She Needs It. We just replace one crush with another. We just stand on the edge of our bodies and wait. We just take the original letter and rewrite it so many times we forget who it was for. Does it matter? Do we hope they remember, hope they keep pulling horsehair from their coat until someone else offers to take that gorgeous animal off their hands? It's just a matter of who keeps bringing your animal home. And you can do that. You can do it. Thanks.
Hi. Thank you for taking the time to listen to my poem. I thought in this unprecedented moment, it would be a little more brave and perhaps interesting to share a poem that I'm still working on. So I'm going to read the first two sections of this poem. And it is called, at least tentatively, You Left Me on a Country Road. You left me on a country road. The curve of CR-28 was a long stretch of deviancies. We could barely see what was ahead. But we could smell vats of cucumbers and vinegar. A tall box elder tree stood in front of the farmhouse, blocking a window. Chairs were propped upside down on the sofa. The living room, dining room, study smelled of mildew. When your grandfather talked about the Great War, I sat on the freezer in his kitchen. He interrupted his story and asked me if I wanted rye or wheat toast. I can't remember anything about the war, but that you needed to warm his orange juice, or that I cooked him chicken and figs with port wine for his last meal, I remember. I was nervous cooking for him. The figs, did I soak them in the port long enough? And the chicken, did it glaze the pan? After his funeral, I saw him waiting for the bus. He wasn't in his wheelchair. He was standing under the bus shelter with a newspaper and a tan derby. My lungs expanded and I took in the June air. I wanted to tell him our secrets. You said kill our secrets. I wanted to say something, but I'm easily silenced. The country road we drove to meet your grandfather was a long stretch of gray, punishing us for being out of reach. We hadn't had sex for months. I found your photo of the farm. It was snowing. and the road, which took up most of the image closest to the foreground, had imprints of snow tires, a few weeds here and there, and two faint footprints in the far right corner at the edge of the photo. The snow, which must have been taken with a slow shutter speed, was incandescent. Many of the snow flakes were small dots, but a few of them were striking in their presence. If not for the other snowflakes, I would not have recognized them as snow, but as white flames shrouded in blue. The effect left me with an urge to walk across the empty road in the middle of a snowstorm, with a longing to find out where it was forecasted to snow and go there, just to see the white flames like arrows darting across the horizon. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is David Watts, and I'm so pleased to be providing some poetry for this wonderful series that Kai has set up. Our thanks to you, Kai, for your inspiration and your brilliance in putting this together. I thought I would recite a poem that has been one of my more well-known poems through the years. And it came to pass in one of those moments when you had nothing in your head at all, and suddenly this poem appears out of nowhere. I was writing it down furiously, trying to get it on the page, because I knew it was going to disappear, and it did. But I got it, and I've been thankful ever since. We have to be thankful for moments like that. So, as is often the case with my poetry, it has to do with someone in my family. And I thought it's appropriate for this particular time we're in now, because it has in it an element of resiliency for the human spirit, something we can use right now. It's called Fragment at the Beginning of Something. My son brings me a stone and asks which star it fell from. He is serious, and so I must be careful. Even though I know he will place it among those things that will leave him someday, and he will go on gathering. For this is one of those moments that turns suddenly towards you, opening as it turns. As if for an instant we pause on the edge of a heartbeat, conscious of the fear that runs beside us, and how lovely it is to be with each other in the long, resilient mornings. So that poem is in this book, Having and Keeping, in case you just have to see it in print. Thanks, everybody. Be well.
I woke up one morning, my heart heavy, I don't trust like I used to. That's deadly, I became more realistic, gave up on optimism. Cops, the blacks, those are ops to hit them. The blocks are prisons, they got us looking through prisms. We're blind to the system, hidden to the way that we should be living. It's a lot of ignorance, no wonder why they ain't fearing us. They think we're illiterate, they're fighting us like militants. They still got us in chains. We can't seem to snatch the one that's on our brains. It continues to remain. I got a question. Is hand freedom really better than none? It's like we're finally getting a plate, but the food's undone. We're being told that we're family, but being treated like a stepson. Content with the progress, they say we gained a ton, but I don't celebrate victories that haven't come. This war is far from won. This war is far from won. Look. Look. Now let me tell you why I think this way. Back to the other day, I noticed they got us brainwashed. They got us working chain jobs like cooks and the janitors. Not many of us scholars and professors. White man playing chess and we stuck on playing checkers. They got us in check just when we thought they was gonna have to king us later. And even when we get one, they gun them down. And then when we make a stride, they make sure it don't happen again. Obama gets in the house, but why you think they made Trump win? It's backlash and backhanded compliments. Even success has consequence. We integrate schools for learning. Whites leave and give us the financial burden, even though they still in charge. So by and large, it loses funding. Fundamental resources become less abundant until we have close to nothing. That's one something, that's one example, this whole system is corrupt. I can only take so many punches to the gut until my core erupts. I'm so full of distrust, interpersonal warfare got my heart feeling crushed. Making it harder for me to love, I get thoughts that make peace tough. All I want is my people up. No matter what it takes, Change is slow, that's unacceptable. We need to speed up the pace. Free of my people, this getting too heavy. I can no longer bear the weight. Lord, take it away. Lord, take it away. Amen.
Hi everyone, I'm Jeannie Roberts, and I'm back again to read two poems for you. I'd like to thank Kai Coggin, who has organized these poetry readings and hosts them beautifully, and I'm grateful to be a part. As I said, I have two poems for you, and both of them are within my full-length poetry collection, Romp and Ceremony. And this was published in 2017 by Finishing Line Press. Editor Kristen Kincaid and publisher Leah Maines. Thank you both. I'll start with a food poem, and then my last poem is about the number 10. And they're lighthearted poems. Hopefully they'll be humorous. And I'll start with Food for Thought. But before I read it, I want to also thank Bruce Taylor, who published this in Volume 1's Local Lit column. And that's here in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. Food for Thought. Oh, praise be tomatoes, noodles, and sauce. Let there be lobster, salmon, and squash. Oh, saute the scallops, pork chops, and ham. Smother the popcorn, Jimmy the jam. Oh, praise be burritos, tacos, and steak. Let there be donuts, cookies, and cake. Oh, pan-fry potatoes, revel in salt. Cascade the gravy, inhale a malt. Oh, praise be risotto, pasta, and roast. Let there be ice cream, root beer with floats. Oh, dine on Doritos, dollop the dip, savor the salsa, deep fry the fish. Oh, lessen my hunger, safeguard my plate, limit my helpings. Oh, resistance can wait. Supersize those fries. Oh, to hell with my weight. I've been eating a lot lately, as I think a lot of us have. We've been, in this time of uncertainty, and being at home, and it's just easy to eat more. So I thought a food poem would be appropriate. My last poem is titled 10. Born on October 10th at 10:10 a.m., 10 fingers, 10 toes, she had a tendency for tens, both the alpha and numeric kind. She was a tender-hearted woman who suffered from tendonitis and lived in a tenement with tenebrous tendencies. On weekends, she rode her 10-speed bike and played tennis. On Sundays, she sang tenor in the choir. She was also religious and followed the Ten Commandments. As a meat eater, she enjoyed preparing beef tenderloin, tenderizing it in her tender way. She wore her hair in tendrils and sometimes even wore her 10-gallon hat, given to her by her Tennessee cousin, Tent. Yes, Tent, not Trent. Though the hat was heavy and gave her intense tension headaches, she tended to dress to the tens, not the nines. She preferred the intensity of tens. And last but not least, she liked to touch it, though without a 10-foot pole, because she was also the daring type. Thank you. I appreciate you taking the time to listen. And again, be safe and well, and have a good day. Thank you. Bye.
Hello, everyone. My name's Annabelle Roca, and I'm submitting again some dance from Ventura, California. This is just a fun one before everything kind of changed. a post-gym sesh. Hope you enjoy, and that you're staying safe.
It's a violent life. You can live to 100, you could die tonight. That's why we getting high tonight, yeah. That's why I let my man drive tonight, yeah. play. Ay, got the cane like an old lady, got the Tony like a Broadway play. Got the cane like an old lady, I'm a titan like Saturn's moon. Kill him softly with kindness and gratitude. Got the attitude like what you said for, nah, I said I had the blues, yeah, yeah. Weed is shit, smoking weed and shit, no stems, no seeds, no sticks, throw an ounce in the crowd like I don't need that shit,
I have recorded this 100 times, quite literally, and so I know that I want to say thank you for pressing play, thank you for being here with me. I am obsessed with poetry through the pandemic. I'm obsessed with Kai. I'm so grateful for all of the artists, poets, musicians, dancers who've uploaded their work week after week, and it's such an honor to be here. Again, thank you for spending this time with me. I'm right here with you. I might be in Portland. You may be where you are. We may be spanning literal space and time, but this poem is for you because it's a modern day love poem. I'm here with my wife, staying safe at home, and I wanted to write a little bit about what it's like to be in love and to also feel that there is a constant expectation for contactability, and I think a lot of us can relate to that. So I hope that you enjoy it. I would love to hear what you think, and again, I just really appreciate you taking the time to listen and connect. So here we go. I'm upside down, falling through time, pretending to stand right side up. She tells me to practice dreaming every day, but the clock says something is due, so I do it. She says the key to dreaming is vulnerability. Dreams only come true right here and right now. But a text says something is due, so I do it. You're not paying attention, she yells, 100 yards ahead now, and I'm running to keep up, but I get a text that something is due, so I do it. And the sun falls out of the sky, and the day is over, and she's gone. She's gone. I'm still running to keep up, but it's too dark to see, so I stop and find myself writing a list of dreams. Each of them is filled with her lips, full of honey and reason. The funny dance she does after hours of cooking or writing. How she listens like nothing and no one else has ever mattered. Her nose, how it crinkles with delight. I write her down over and over again until in the distance, moonlight catches a smooth curve. Her cheek. Brown eyes full of glitter, and holy shit, she's here. She says, so you were listening, and pulls me close, and we're still falling upside down, but I hold on tight now. Time is a teacher, always moving, never tame, and I'm learning that love is a dream that only comes true with practice.
Magic lives everywhere, especially in stitches. Stitches are doors and doors are portals. I walk through my red kitchen door. I'm 8 years old. My mother is crushed under a black refrigerator, and later she tells me that she only meant to kick it. Y quien sabía que era tan fuerte? But I still remember the infant look in her eye when she asked me if I thought she needed stitches. Creo que sí, I said, and I held her hand the whole time. After we eat chocolate ice cream, I put her to bed, and I sit on the pale pink couch in the cold living room. Moonshine creeps in my skin, I look at my hands, I see letters, I try to read them, but they turn into shadows, and now I remember that magic lives everywhere, especially in stitches. Stitches are portals, portals are doors, doors unlock worlds, where blue roses bloom at midnight and fairies dance with tigers. Worlds where mother means mother and daughter means daughter. Demeter loses Persephone to the underworld 6 months a year. The wheat in her heart wilts and her flesh is gray until come spring Persephone breaks through the surface of the red earth with pomegranate stains framing her mouth like a bad secret. My mother always taught me to open doors myself. Don't wait for magic, make magic. So, with moonshine in my hands, I climb off the pale pink couch and pull it a few inches away from the craggy white wall. With a cheap ballpoint pen, I draw an ink door on the wall. And with blue pressed palms, I pray safety is on the other side of this door. I see sun-streaked grass covered in honey and coffee that doesn't burn and mothers that don't bleed ethanol. Safety tastes like a deep breath. Safety sounds like promises that are never weaponized. And right now, safety is this blue door, and I know that everything I need is on the other side. And I can only open this door one time because once I do, I'll never come back. So every night, for 7 years, when things get scary, I sit next to the blue door and I tell myself, wait a little longer, a little longer. Espera un poquito más, because surely I'm stronger than this. Surely, it's always darkest right before dawn, so I touch my door until my hands turn blue, I close my eyes. And I watch the sun rise like Persephone.
Hi, happy Earth Day. By the time you watch this video, it will be Wednesday, Earth Day. My name is Christina Norcross. Very happy to be here on Wednesday with Kai Coggin's Wednesday Night Poetry Virtual Open Mic. This is my third time appearing. I've been trying to alternate weeks, so sometimes I'm here and joining in, and sometimes I'm listening and watching on Wednesday evenings and enjoying everyone's offerings. In honor of the theme of Earth Day and nature, I'm sharing a poem tonight from a collection called Living Nature's Moments, which was a collaboration I did with the very talented photographer Patricia Bashford, who's based in Newburyport, Massachusetts. Pat and I worked on this collection for 2 years. She would send me images by email of her beautiful nature photography, and I would write a poem in response. So this is just one poem from the collection. It's called Nature's Architecture, and I'll hold up, there's one of Pat's photographs is of blue mussel shells. Nature's architecture. Like a kalo beaded necklace, a painter's adornment of intricate beauty, a sea life sculpture takes shape. Open and closed mouth shells arrange themselves, blue-gray surfaces polished by the sea. Clustered barnacles swell, a mass of ocean treasures attach themselves with such confidence, steadfast. A seemingly random design gives birth to a blooming flowered shell. Imagination takes flight, reveling in the joy of nature's clever architecture. We cling to what we can see when true strength comes from the footholds of faith. Invisible to human vision, when the heart is constant, all is in balance, all is beauty. Thank you very much.
Hello, Wednesday Night Poetry. My name is Colin Kelly, and I'm going to read a poem from my latest collection, Midnight in a Perfect World, published by Sibling Rivalry Press. This poem is called Killing Time. I can almost pretend I'm elsewhere. 4:30, the light nearly gone, like that afternoon walk in Leicester Square when I was filled with dark joy, the cold and damp bone deep in that pervasive London way. I grew up in an oppressive climate, air laden with hiss and moisture. I envy regions with short days, charting weather patterns for low-lying clouds and threats of rain. My cure for seasonal affective disorder? Turn out the lights. Autumn comes later now, thanks to politicians and lobbyists with nothing better to do than kill time. Days linger as landscapes turn gray, the wind in the leaves telegraphing in cracks and shutters for the night to come. Thanks for listening.
Shh. Yeah, right. Never. You know how sometimes you trip over something and there's a half second where you're not sure if you'll be able to catch yourself or not? That half second of pure terror? That's where I live. Every single day. In that half second. Possessed by demons, the fight for a cerebral cerebellum, feeling out of control. Overcome by emotion, my face a sauna of tears.
They say your strength overpowers the weakness. You're so powerful. No, I will lose. I am losing. I'm now lost. A consistent internal fight with one's greatest weapon, intoxicated with hate, with pain, with disgust of one's own being. Just breathe. Inhale, exhale. I can't. Fighting to take in any air, let alone a deep breath. Imagine losing control of your heart, your chest, physical pain knocking you down. No one can find out why, because no one believes you. Hearing but not listening, writing but not accepting, you begin to hate the words, I understand. A gentle hand on your arm feels like needles. Too much work to push it away. My life is a voodoo doll. 18 months of consistent nausea, leaving me dry heaving daily, even today. 8 years later, the wound is still fighting to get dressed every day. Shh. Yeah, right. Never.
Imagine you're a bird who flew south and landed to view a branch of a family tree that would be broken into you. The color of cardinal would spill from your innocent growth. What kind of love is there after being raped of your yolk? It's foul for a fowl to be defiled and left sore when you were meant to soar. Think of a chain of chirps choked by murder of crows. A foreign tongue weighted like a tombstone. What voice is there after silence gets deep? It's scary when you bury the canary carols behind your beak and no longer reach for lessons under someone's wing. You could learn to vulture yourself. Esteem. What kind of education is there after dropping out of school? Picture the places you have craned as nothing but clouds and the blues. It's easy to be flipped off when you falcon that low into misery. What kind of daughterhood is there after teen pregnancy? When eggs hatched, you chicken scratched to live after the shock. Now see sacrificing your two-piece breast and thigh for every peacock. What kind of affection is there after prostitution steals you slowly? Being a swan for a moment does not erase a whole childhood of ugly. You single-leggedly flamingoed chicks to spread ego and be arrested into your pecking order of evil. So tell me, what kind of mentoring is there after being a madam? What if you knew how it felt to float and the feeling of flocks flapping to see you? But when you finally figure out you had feathers from an angel of light, consider that your guardian dove told you, take flight. You were the sparrow God's eye was on. For instance, envision phoenixing your charred past into a starred existence. Dream you no longer hid your ostrich head. Now wake up with eyes bright. And my Angelo, those hurts. You must take flight and leave those winds of woe under you like she would fly. She danced like a rockin' robin, dodging drops of rain. She could parody motion and turn the stage into her sky. She was a hummingbird harmonizing over hostility's scream. Her hawk eye toward progress was keen. Challenge was water on a duck's back to her era of action. The word poet does not account for her wingspan. So let her work forever be in the canon.
Hi, my name is Megan Merchant. I live in Prescott, Arizona. First and foremost, thank you for curating this space. One of the things that has been helping to keep me connected or feel connected has been the opportunity to be able to listen to all of these incredible artists and poets and see them and experience their work. So thank you very much. I'm going to share a poem today from my book that was just released with Stillhouse Press. It's called Before the Fevered Snow. And releasing a book during a pandemic has been a very interesting experience. But I'm grateful to be able to connect some of this work to an audience right now. So thank you. Oh, and it's a love poem. Salt ring. I show up at his door. He knows little about how to embrace me, if it is wrong to hold, and for how long. Unsure what happens after time has been between bodies that once kissed crevices of dark. What permission the past holds. He touches my cheek, says, I never regretted you. Please, don't make me do that now. He invites me in, pours whiskey, neat, the long hardening of amber. I find a letter on his desk between stacks of hardcover books, my letter. He folded it into a paper airplane, drew rows of passengers in pencil. They are speechless, grim-lipped. I say, there should be flames, so he knows I'm there as something to be extinguished. The wings are still intact, he says, and that is too much hope. There is mercy in the amount of light that slats between us. There's mercy in our quiet. I say, I loved you. He nods, pulls me close, and there is a litany of bees thrumming my spine, my skin, a season of subtle gray and violets, his arms still the shape of waiting. I tried. I learned that dahlias go best in dirt that is tart, mixed with finely ground bones. What else? He asks. I look at his bed, the untucked sheets. That has nothing to do with us, he says. A salt ring around the window, the tapestry of an ocean exhaling. Then play for me. He places the curved body of a guitar between my legs, strums. Thank you.
My name is Bill McLeod, and I bring you two poems from my home in Pryor, Oklahoma, up in the northeast corner of the state, almost in Arkansas. This is called All Those Days of Poems So Sad, and it was published in Conclave. When is the best day to write a sad poem? I cannot say for sure, but I do recall that I wrote two the day that I was born, and one when I first tasted ice cream, and another when I learned to ride a bike, and that one in school when I made my first A. And I seem to recall one when I heard the Beatles, and when I found that $100 bill. And on our first date, when we had that kiss, I wrote a sad poem into your mouth. And none of the previous ones were ever as sad as I had once imagined them to be. And a poem from Tejas Cavito. Suspicion. At this moment, what I hate most about this shutdown is on the rare occasions that I go out, I look suspiciously at every single person I meet. Do they have it? Are they going to give it to me? And I hate that. It goes against all I've ever believed in. But I saw you yesterday, and it made me suspicious.
All right, hi, my name is Brian Motes, and I'm going to read a poem to you all this week called Hanging the Bat House. Hanging the Bat House. white-knuckling the swaying branchless pine, 23 feet high, this is also where I keep my fog knife safe. Folded up in the airstream, it rains, it is raining. Great puddles of thunk, just deep enough to drown an Indian runner under the weight of some other fat duck. Water seeks gaps in suet to ruin bird seed, to keep me in bed, to yawn all over me. I begin to rumor clarity the moment I hear thunder on the way, bouncing over the surface of the forest's ready mysteries. They have settled and spread out as a fog at 23 feet above the valley floor. I can see down into what used to be a cattle dipping pond, where at least one horse is buried and lawnmower batteries rot out now. I can hear geese. I can smell rooftops. It still rumbles. Then the fatness of dawn and its sister, the overfed cat, join me at the top of the swaying branchless pine. We sway. We are swaying. We never know where to go with this moment. We never know where to go with this top-heavy moment. Like three sedate Harold Lloyds, accidentally going on with things, slicing nothing. Thank you.
Hi. Mona from Hot Springs. I feel this is the best of the time, and it's the worst of the time. Like always, there are two mantras, yum and yup. Coronavirus did a magical thing for me. It took me from my doism to my expensive, deep beingness, where I got connected with everything there is. I'm connected to Mother Earth again, to my plants, to my birds, to my lake. I listen to their stories these days. The lake is creating a lot of life in its womb. The birds travel, bring me the stories of different places. Though my trees cannot travel, but they are observer of the crazy human behavior. I'm connected to my heart. How many gallons it pumps every day for me. I'm thankful to my lungs, for my breathing. Listen to my breathing. Thankful to my eyes, nose, my ears, and all my organs, every cell of my human form. And thankful to be in this human body. I'm so much in joyful state these days, so much connected. I swing on my swing and sing and dance and take shower in the colors of my flowers and their fragrance. Even I love my falling hair also. I did my mom's gooseberry massage from India. The oil came from India. I massage myself body oil with Indian almond oil today and had the best Indian tea with all spices. Thankful for turmeric and all the wonderful spices and herbs. So, be yummy. Yuck is everywhere. So say yummy words, dance your yumminess, get into your expensive yummy side, smile a lot. Look at the kids, laughter. I got some chicks, I play with them. I play with the kittens and puppies. So fine, beauty, not poo, but yumminess. And write the poem or poem of yumminess, not poo. Be yum yum. Thank you.
My name is Paula Martin, and this poem is from my upcoming book called What I Know, which is a collaboration with artist Sandra Holden. And this is What I Know 1. The stone on your windowsill sings medicine songs while you sleep. The oak in your yard encircles your whole house with light. The river you drive over carries your shame effortlessly downstream. The mountain in the distance prays for you in an ancient tongue. And the moon outside your window, who's been patiently waiting your whole life for you to remember, cradles your dreams against her milky white breast, your story in the palm of her hand.
Hello, everyone. I'm Steven Anderson, a Milwaukee-based poet. And today I'm happy to share a poem with you from my new poetry collection, The Dream Angel Plays the Cello. I think that the dire times that we're experiencing put us in need of the spirit raising that poetry and other art can provide. So my poem today is called Quest. Under the starry net cast above is the full-blown gladness of a Beethoven symphony on a midsummer's night. Here all is spoken in images at the juncture of the lucid and the luminous, where transcendence pulls one into infinity, where logic and pattern and ethereal matters duel under impermanent stars on slow burn, where the bioluminescent glow of fireflies catch and hold the imagination along with quiet majesty of cedar and poplar trees, beech rows, mounds of moss, where nature is in her glory even through the surreal fog of afternoon. We're all made of star stuff. Let us not deceive ourselves. At least 10% of all stars have at least one habitable planet, dollops of rock in perpetual time slide, and we strive to content ourselves in the silky silence of our third planet from the sun, and amid nature in her glory, we inhale, we exhale. Thank you.
Greetings, everybody. My name is S. Mora. I'm going to be reading a piece called Lockbox, and I hope you enjoy it. You are the key to my lock. You've unleashed my floodwaters, breaking boundaries, revealing secrets foreign to my body. And it's hard for me to move on to another body because I know it's only one key. That leads me to that euphoric place. And you plus me is the magic combination that leads us to orgasmic constellations. Our bodies dance while having orgasmic conversations. Our moans is our music. I wish I could leave our song on repeat. I get chills all over my body thinking about those yummy excursions. How revolutionary of us to love on each other freely. How revolutionary of us to sex on each other freely, to exist freely in front of each other while being so unapologetic. Mother Earth's children of the wild connecting like the fiery stars in the sky. Our story was already written when I hugged you. Our story was already written when I first kissed you. Our story was already written the night you unlocked my box.
For Kimberly. Staring at my blood-red Nikes, I'm reminded of him. The way a cop thought himself magic, turned gun into cape, Bradley, the only one to disappear behind the bars. We speak of Jesus, a brown-skinned rabble-rouser who cast out demons and sent an army of pigs to their death. Down the hall, comrades and punks turn full-on girl riot, smear their sandwiches across the wall, flood the toilet, wait for baptism, all the while knowing the system cannot be saved, but the rain comes anyway. The tears of 1,000 mothers flood the cell, each drop a memory and a prayer for resurrection soon. There is a river, and we are children wading in the water. A slow simmer, and the whole room boils. Here, we are birthed anew. We arrived in protest and depart with it.
Hi guys, happy Wednesday night poetry. I miss you all so much. So much, and I miss you dearly.
Okay. Just take two.
Take one. Broke the microphone.
Hello, poets. We're sorry we're outside. If there's cars that go by, this is the best setting. We want some greenery since no one's going outside right now. My name is Shane Kalp. Poets, people are listening to your poems and studying them, so submit them. Kai, you're wonderful. Everyone's wonderful, but you are really wonderful. My poem's called Sounds Enough. It was written to a woman who didn't write back, but she's a happily married English professor at Vassar now, so she's fine. Your voice, your eyes, your face, they pierce me, the mind there, the beauty. The dark pupils, a laser-focused incision across my ear. I hadn't heard that sound before, so mesmerized by you. I closely watch the shifting hue that rests somewhere in brown and blue behind your eyes that hide from me. Your eyelash grid on reality. But now I listen, and that sound unveiled a fear may be the sound of loneliness in me, a rasp like thirst to hold your vision, reminding me that I'm in prison, wishing not with your decision to tilt your ear to me and hear the flutter of my heart, the nervous twitter of you near, the dear twinge of pain. And if you listen close, the gaze of eyes across the page, and the gentle rustle of the blaze, its wordless whisper. Its words are falling ashes from the fires of these passions. My pen's quiet scratching to your voice, your eyes, your face, the mind there. The ultrasonic boom that echoes back and forth like gardens trading legends aptly verdant. Likewise, I whisper ardent promises to illumine darkness, that if you lent your ears to me, the loneliness of sound would be a Wagnerian melody. Like seraphim, my heart would sing if you'd accept the love I bring. I'm rambling though, you're deaf by now, but sure of my young crush and thou. So let me ask you one last thing. Are sounds enough for this courting?
Thank you.
Greetings from Minnesota. I am an artist. I create art daily, and poetry comes through my art as I'm creating it. So here is a piece I created called Hanging Man. Sometimes I feel as though I've been hung out to dry, to wither, become lighter and lighter, and then I fly freely with the wind, so paper thin. No bones remain, no marrow, no DNA, only matter. Matter, the particles that make up the air we breathe. You breathe me in, I reach your heart, I caress your soul. I am your lost lover, your thought control. You remember the love we felt, the ups, the downs, the do-si-dos, the walks through towns. We tiptoed through the tulips. We wrote messages in the sand. Your hand in mine, mine in yours, our hearts beating, pounding the rhythm of love. I hold my breath, hanging on to every fleeting moment, thinking good things aren't made to last. I exhale. You remain. I refrain. My thoughts have softened.